Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Dr. Sanjeev Pandey. I'm an associate professor in botany at Banwarilal Bhalotia College, Asansol, West Bengal, India. In this video lecture, I'm going to talk about tripopyron. In the last video lecture, we discussed about lacopyron, which is the basic operon from which the story of operon begins. So if you want to have an idea about operon, you can watch the previous video. The link will be provided below. The trip operon, this lecture will be divided into three parts. The first part will be about the basic control of trip operon, particularly in Escherichia coli. The part two will be about the variations of some of the variations that occur in some other bacteria, particularly about the transcription attenuation. And the third video will be about the function of the small peptide and also the attenuated small RNA that is being produced during attenuation in some bacteria. So the later two videos will be of a little bit of postgraduate and higher level, maybe for the CSIR NET aspirants and GRE aspirants. So let's begin the lecture from the part one. So before going to the tryptophan operon, a brief recapitulation about the genes and operons. We have already talked about them many a times, but genes are of two types. One is called constitutive genes or housekeeping genes, and the other ones are called regulatory genes. Operons are set of genes that are regulated by a single operator and promoter regions. So basically, operons they are present in bacterial system, prokaryotic system rather, and in case of eukaryotic system, each gene is uniquely regulated by a single proton promoter and operator. So in case of eukaryotes, the operon system is exceptional. Normally, it is absent. So operon is an operational unit in which number of genes, structural genes, are expressed together with the help of a promoter operator region. So regulatory genes are those genes which are dependent on the conditions, environmental conditions. If the situation demands, then these genes and operons will be expressed, otherwise they will remain switch off. They are of two types, inducible and repressible. Inducible operons are like the lac operon, and it is a kind of a catabolite operon, means when the substrate will be present, the enzymes for degradation or catabolism of that substrate needs to be synthesized. So these operons normally remain switched off, and when the substrate arrives, they are induced by the substrate or a derivative of the substrate to be expressed, and they are switched on after the arrival of the substrate. So that's why they are called inducible. Whereas the other one, that is the repressible operon, they are anabolic operon. They are basically biosynthetic, those operons, those genes that are involved in biosynthesis process, like the trip operon. Tryptophan is an amino acid, which is an essential amino acid and needs to be synthesized in the cell. And for that, these genes, there are five genes involved in that, we will see that. Those are involved in the biosynthetic process of tryptophan. And normally the synthesis is going on in the cell, so the gene is under switched on mode normally. But when the level of the tryptophan or similar other, maybe histidine, phenylalanine, these kind of amino acids are also similar kind of operons. When the level of these metabolites increases to or becomes sufficient in the cell, then they themselves repress the expression of the genes required for their biosynthesis. So that's why it is called repressible. And that's because it is a biosynthetic process, these kind of operons are called anabolic operons. So here is the structure of trip operon, as in case of Escherichia coli. A trip operon comprises of five genes, namely trip E, trip D, C, B, and A. And there is a single promoter and operator region. And in between the operator and the trip E, there is a segment called leader sequence or trip L. So this is the regulatory element before the structural genes, these five structural genes. And there is another regulatory gene that is called TRPR, which is present a little far away from the actual TRP operon. This gene synthesizes a protein, a repressor, which is normally an aporepressor, an inactive repressor. So we will see how these repressors and these structural genes, how they function, how this entire TRP operon functions under the low concentration of tryptophan and under the sufficient concentration or high concentration of tryptophan in the cell. So before going into this regulation, a little bit of idea about this. These genes, the TRPE, D, C, B, and A, they actually synthesize a polycystronic mRNA, and from that, five different kinds of enzymes are produced, like these anthranilate synthase, anthranilate phosphoribosyl transferase, phosphoribosyl anthranilate isomerase, indole glycerol phosphate synthase, and tryptophan synthase. And by this five-step process, chorismate or chorismic acid is finally converted into tryptophan. So if you want to understand the biochemistry of this, you can have a look, we can delve about that further. But here we are actually concerned with the expression of or regulation of this TRP operon. So we are moving on. So regulation of TRP operon in Escherichia coli and some other bacteria also is based on two mechanisms. One is called negative control, the other is the fine control, which is called transcription attenuation. So negative control is a coarse regulation and transcription attenuation is a fine regulation. We will see that, how does this operate. So first of all, negative regulation. It is called negative regulation because the operon is actually in positive mode. It is being, it is transcribing, it is expressing when the cell has a less concentration of tryptophan. So tryptophan has to be made in the cell. And for that, these genes have to be expressed. So what happens, the TRPR synthesizes an mRNA from which a repressor is synthesized, and that is actually an incomplete repressor. It is an inactive repressor called aporepressor. So this repressor is unable to bind with the operator under this conformation, and that's why the RNA polymerase, it binds with the promoter region and it starts transcription. And a polycystronic mRNA is produced, out of which five different enzymes are produced, as we saw in the previous slide, that the biochemistry of tryptophan synthesis. Finally, the substrate, that is the chorismate, is converted into tryptophan. So the tryptophan concentration gradually builds up in the cell. So gradually and gradually, when tryptophan becomes sufficient in the cell and no more tryptophan is required, because we know that excess of something is wasteful, and the cell would not like to synthesize excess tryptophan because it has to invest a lot of energy for doing that. So what will happen when the sufficient amount of tryptophan level will be sufficient in the cell? That tryptophan will bind with the aporepressor. It will act like a corepressor and it will bind with the aporepressor and will convert the aporepressor into a active repressor. This active repressor will now bind with the promoter operator region. A little bit about promoter region also. So if it binds here, the RNA polymerase will not be able to bind in the promoter or will be blocked by this repressor and will not be able to synthesize the transcribe the genes downstream. So when the tryptophan level is sufficiently high in the cell, the TRP operon is negatively regulated. It is repressed by this mechanism, by the tryptophan itself. It binds with the aporepressor, and this now becomes a true repressor, active repressor, that can block the transcription. So this is how tryptophan negative regulation takes place. But this is not by this method, the TRP operon is not regulated 100%. It is merely about 70% of regulation occurs by this method, because the binding of the active repressor is also not very efficient. Momentarily, this repressor can dissociate from this operator region and a certain amount of transcription might take place if the fine regulation is absent. that attenuation process, the next part. So to control that, so that this snake synthesis means momentary synthesis when the repressor is not bound with the operator region, in that time the RNA polymerase, between that those fractions of time, the RNA polymerase binds and it synthesizes polycystronic mRNA. From that, the protein synthesis also take place, and then the enzymes will be produced. So since sufficient amount of tryptophan is already present in the cell, those transcriptions and translations will become a wasteful process. So that is not justified in the cell that should occur. So to control that, this fine regulation is there, this transcription attenuation. So how does it operate? This system is not present in lacoperon or catabolic operons. In catabolic operons, the story is a little bit different. I will not talk about them here. It will become a lengthy lecture then. So there is a gene segment called TRIP-L or leader sequence between the operator and TRIP-E gene. What is the function of this? This gene is actually the responsible for this fine regulation. It will not allow the intermittent synthesis or sneak synthesis of tryptophan genes, transcription. So TRIP-L, it regulates finally regulates that the sneak synthesis does not occur. How does it do so? The TRIP-L is about 162 base pair long DNA element. This one is the transcript RNA element. Within this transcript, there are four such segments which can hybridize together. Segment 1, segment 2 can hybridize together, forming a pause site, a secondary structure, which is not an attenuator. Segment 2 and segment 3 can also hybridize, and they will result in the formation of an anti-terminator. And when segment 3 and segment 4 will hybridize, it will form an attenuator, because this secondary structure is followed by a stretch of U, which is basically an attenuator for the row independent transcription termination. So you can see, since the hybridization is such a kind of here, the hybridization is taking place between 1 and 2, 2 and 3, and 3 and 4. So if 1 and 2 hybridize, 2 and 3 cannot hybridize, because 2 is already busy with 1. And when 2 and 3 will hybridize, 3 and 4 cannot hybridize, because 3 is busy with 2. So these hybridizations are mutually exclusive to each other. And that is the interesting story. Under certain condition, under low tryptophan condition, we will see that the attenuation will not occur and the transcription of the downstream gene will take place. And that is required because the tryptophan level is low, it has to be synthesized. But when tryptophan level is high, no transcription should occur, and that's why this attenuator will be formed under that condition. Let's see how. The segment 1, it contains two trip codons consecutively, one after another, side by side. So this is the sensor which actually senses the low concentration of tryptophan in the cell. Basically, when tryptophan is low, then the tryptophenyl tRNA trip, the amino acylated tRNA for the tryptophan, that is called tryptophenyl tRNA trip, that RNA is less in the cell. So what happens? And one thing has to be remembered here, that in prokaryotes, transcription and translations are coupled. So when transcription is taking place, when this part is being transcribed from promoter to this region, immediately it is followed by the ribosomes, because in prokaryotes there is no nuclear membrane. So the ribosomes which are present in the cytoplasm or protoplasm, they get easy access to bind with the nascent RNA that is being synthesized immediately. And they start translation also. So what happens here also, the ribosomes, they follow the RNA polymerase, just behind them, the RNA polymerase. So, and this ribosome, when it comes to face the segment 1, under low tryptophan condition, it finds two trip codons here, and for which the level of tryptophenyl tRNA trip is very, very low in the cell. Because of that, this ribosome has to wait for some time that the tryptophan LTR and TRP will come and bind with this the codon. The anticodon of that will bind with the codon, and the protein synthesis will continue. Because here is a small ORF present within this region. This trip codon is part of that open reading frame. That is that produces about 14 amino acid long protein. So this ribosome is synthesizing that small protein. And while doing so, when it faces this trip codon and when the concentration of the tryptophan is low, the tryptophanyl tRNA are not available in the cell, and that's why it waits for them to arrive here, but it does not arrive, or it takes time to arrive. During that, in the meanwhile, what happens? The segment 2 hybridizes with segment 3, because these two are free. 3 and 4 are also free, but the chance of hybridization of 2 and 3 is greater because this is longer segment. So, when 2 and 3 hybridize, 3 and 4 cannot hybridize, and then 2 and 3 is basically anti-terminator. So termination will not take place. When 2 and 3 hybridize, it forms a secondary structure which is an anti-terminator. How it is an anti-terminator? Because it engages the segment 3. If that segment hybridizes with segment 4, it will lead to the formation of an attenuator. So it is blocking the formation of attenuator by engaging the segment 3 by this hybridization method. And that is required because the cellular level of tryptophan is low, and the transcription should not be attenuated at this point of time. Transcription has to occur. The downstream genes should be transcribed for the synthesis of the enzymes that will finally lead to the synthesis of tryptophan in the cell. So that's what happens when tryptophan level is low. When tryptophan level is high, the tryptophanyl tRNA trip concentration is also high. So ribosome immediately gets those tRNAs, those are tagged with tryptophan, tryptophanyl tRNA trip. They immediately come and bind with these regions, the codon regions of tryptophan, and the transcription immediately, the ribosomes immediately proceeds to engage segment 2. When it binds and it passes fast this region and it occupies the segment 2 also, then segment 2 is not available to hybridize with segment 3. And that's why segment 3 can hybridize with segment 4 now. And the attenuator of this kind will be formed. A rho-independent attenuator, this one is. And automatically the RNA polymerase, which is transcribing, which is just here, when it will face this part in the DNA here, this will switch off. This will fall down. It will dissociate from the DNA. The RNA-DNA hybrid region will dissociate because there's a stretch of U. When it hybridizes with stretch of A in the DNA, the hybridization is not very strong, and it will automatically dissociate. This part has been discussed in transcription part in the termination in some other video. So this is how attenuation occurs, and no further transcription. Downstream genes are not transcribed. The transcription stops here. And that is what required because the tryptophan level in the cell is already very high. So no further tryptophan synthesis should occur. No SNK synthesis should occur. So this is how this fine regulation of tryptophan occurs in case of Escherichia coli. And it does not allow any small amount even of this polycystronic mRNA, downstream mRNA, has to synthesize because that will lead to a wastage of energy. So up to this video lecture was about the tryptophan regulation, the two mechanisms that operate in case of Escherichia coli. And the second part will start from here. And this will include some of the very interesting phenomena or features that are present in some other bacteria. So here I will talk about the variations of attenuation, particularly in two bacteria, the Bacillus subtilis and Caenorhizobium melilotti, the soil bacterium. Both of them are soil bacterium, in fact. So let us proceed. In case of Bacillus subtilis, the attenuation is not based on the trip codon mechanism. And let me tell you that the previous mechanism, there is a terminology I forgot to mention there. That terminology, the attenuation that occurs in case of Escherichia coli, because it is based on ribosome following the RNA polymerase, And the attenuation process is based on ribosomes, translation process. That's why that attenuation is called ribosome-mediated transcription attenuation. So this is also ribosome-mediated transcription attenuation because protein synthesis is immediately following the transcription in case of all prokaryotes, in fact. So since it is an mRNA, the protein, the ribosome will come and bind, will and proceed. And if the attenuator is formed, the transcript will terminate there, and also the translation will also not occur beyond that part. So this region contains an ORF that produces a small peptide. That we'll talk about the function of that peptide, we will talk about in the third video. So what happens in case of Bacillus subtilis? In Bacillus subtilis, the trip codons, consecutive trip codons, are absent. Rather, this mechanism, the attenuator formation is dependent on a protein called TRAP, this tRNA activating RNA binding protein. tryptophan activated RNA binding protein, that is called TRAP. This TRAP protein actually regulates the attenuation, whether attenuation will occur or not, and that depends on the concentration of the tryptophan. When the tryptophan level is low, attenuator will not be formed, because these trap proteins, though they are present in the cell, they cannot polymerize to form a structure like this. This is an 11-mer structure, this ring-like structure, that is formed with the help of the tryptophan moieties that are present in between each of the subunits, and they help to construct this 11-mer ring-like structure. When the tryptophan level is high, then only this structure can be formed. When tryptophan level is low, this 11-mer ring-like structure will not be formed. And in that case, the RNA will be in this form. It will form a secondary structure here, which is a pause site. And again, it will form a secondary structure here, which is also an anti-terminator, because this hybridization blocks the formation of the attenuator. So this is an anti-terminator. The attenuator part is within this segment, in fact. So this is 1, 2, this is 3, and this is probably 4. So this is not 3, 4, this is half of the 3, half of the 4 part segment. So what happens? When this tryptophan level is high, the TRAP protein, they polymerize to form a structure like this, and the RNA from that contains a segment that wraps around the TRAP polymer, 11-mer ring-like structure around that, like this. And under that situation, the downstream RNA that forms an attenuator like this. It is followed by a stretch of U. So this forms an attenuator, and the RNA polymerase that is proceeding transcription that comes and passes this area, it automatically stops transcription. Further, row independent transcription termination takes place here. So this is how, in case of Bacillus subtilis, the situation is different from that of Escherichia coli. The next one is how it is different in case of Synorhizobium meliloti. It is far more complicated and different. Normally, when tryptophan level is high, the leader peptide, that is the small peptide that is formed from this region, this is an ORF. In fact, if I go to this place, the leader sequence, trip L sequence, it comprises of 162 base pair long segment, the first part of which is an ORF. And this trip codon are part of that ORF, and this synthesizes a small protein, about 14 amino acid long small protein. When tryptophan level is high, then this synthesis takes place, because at that time the tryptophanyl tRNA trip are available in the cell. So this, what does this small peptide do? That is one question. And what does this attenuated mRNA do when both of them are synthesized? What do the peptide do actually, and what do these attenuator RNAs do? That we will discuss. Here we are talking about mainly about the attenuated RNA, and in the next video we will talk about this peptide trip L. Both are functional in case of Synorhizobium elegans, but in case of Escherichia coli, both these things are probably, they have no function. So normally when the tryptophan level is high, the leader peptide that is called peptide trip L, which is 14 amino acid long small protein, is efficiently translated, and the small attenuated RNA is called the RNTRPL, which harbors the trip L, which is present within the trip L region, is generated. Usually these attenuated RNAs and leader peptides are considered non-functional in case of Escherichia coli, but these are not non-functional in case of Cynorhizobium here. In Cynorhizobium meliloti, the tryptophan biosynthesis genes are in fact organized into three different operons. Trip E is present in one operon, trip D, C is present in another operon, and trip BA are present in a different operon. So these three operons, they are present with some other genes also, which are responsible for other functions like nodule formation and other things. So these genes E, D, C and BA, they are located separately on three different operons. Of these, only the first one, that is trip EG, contains the short segment, that trip L segment, and that trip L segment contains the short ORF in the 5 prime UTR. That region is 5 prime untranslated regions, that's why it is called 5 prime UTR, the upper region. And that's why it is also called UORF, because it follows the upstream region and is regulated by transcription attenuation. This trip E is regulated normally, as it the case is about Escherichia coli, that there are trip codons there, and exactly same, the trip E is regulated by the same mechanism, attenuation mechanism, just like the Escherichia coli. But the trip DC genes are not regulated in that way. Under conditions of trip sufficiency, transcription is terminated automatically, attenuation occurs between trip L and trip E gene, and a small attenuator RNA that is called RNTRPL is produced. The RNTRPL base pairs with the trip D, the other operon, and this destabilizes the polycystronic trip DC mRNA, indicating a RNA trip L mediated downregulation of the TRPDC operon. We will see that in the next video, next lecture rather, next slide. So here, this is the trip L segment, that when tryptophan level is high, it produces an attenuated RNA like this, which is called RNTRPL, and it also produces a small peptide called PE trip L. So let's concentrate on these two things. First of all, let's concentrate on this one. So in the next video in part 3, we will talk about this. In case of Escherichia coli, these two things are non-functional. They are probably degraded after some time. But here, this attenuation blocks the synthesis of trip E. That is true. But it also, because the trip E is present in a separate operon, trip DC is present in different operon, and trip AB are again present on a separate operon. So under trip transcription at tryptophan sufficiency, when the tryptophan level is high, this small RNTRPL attenuated RNA is produced, and it blocks the transcription, blocks the translation rather. Post-transcriptional regulation. Transcription occurs, but those transcripts are degraded. The other gene, this is also related with some other gene related to nodule formation. Here you concentrate only about trip DC. So when these red colored RNA are actually this small RNTRPL, they are attenuator RNA. When they are produced, when the tryptophan level is sufficient in the cell, and they will also hybridize with the trip DC region, particularly trip D, like this, and will form double-strand RNA. This double-strand RNA will finally lead to RNA interference and will cleave this mRNA into pieces, and no protein synthesis further will occur. So this is how this small RNTRPL attenuator RNA functions in case of Cynorhizobium elegans, and it inhibits the it post-transcriptionally regulates, like an antisense mechanism, the synthesis of DC enzymes responsible for those enzymes synthesized from these genes, DC elements. And when these three enzymes are not produced, then automatically tryptophan synthesis will not occur. There is no reason of trip A, B to be produced. When this thing is taking place, references are, there are reports that this RNTRPL has some other functions. They also regulate the concentration of RNA of some other genes like SYN-I gene, which is responsible for quorum sensing for root nodule formation. So that mRNA is also degraded or decayed. Here the decay is not directly by hybridization of this TRPL with the mRNA, this mRNA, because they're non-specific. For that reason, certain kind of chaperones are also formed that actually helps this TRPL, RNA TRPL, to hybridize with SYN-I gene, and consequently the degradation of RNA takes place. So this was about the variations of attenuation and how this RNTRPL, this attenuator, are the role of this RNA, RNTRPL, small attenuator RNA, in Sonorizobium elegans. We talked about the variations of attenuation process in Bacillus and Sonorizobium elegans in this video lecture. In part 3 of the video lecture, we will discuss about the peptide, small peptide that is formed. The story is far more interesting in case of Sonorizobium melilotii, that this is linked with the expression of this is linked with multi-drug resistance in this bacterium, very interestingly. So let us first see how multi-drug resistance is regulated. Multi-drug resistance in case of Sonorizobium is based on a multi-drug efflux pump. So when antibiotics like the tetracycline, erythromycin, chloramphenicol, and the flavonoid like genistein are administered to the cell, these are actually effluxed. So an efflux pump needs to be expressed in more amount at that time when these antibiotics are being added to the cell. So how that the concentration or expression of the efflux pump is triggered? So that is dependent on the operon called multi-drug efflux operon, SMEAB. And in fact, there are three genes, SMEA, SMEB, and SMER. So this comprises the operon for the multi-drug efflux pump. So here the situation is this, when there is less amount, of, when the antibiotics are absent, these antibiotics, tetracycline, erythromycin, chloramphenicol, these protein synthesis inhibitor antibiotics, and also the genistein, when they're absent, then SMER segment, normally it inhibits the synthesis of, it is a repressor for the expression of this SMEA and SMEB when the antibiotics are absent, because there is no need of expression of this multi-drug efflux pump when antibiotics is not present. But when antibiotic is added, then what happens? This repression is removed immediately. How? This there are two promoters. In fact, one promoter is at the upstream region, which transcribes a polycystronic mRNA comprising of SMEA, B, and R, entire segment. But there is another promoter at the downstream, and that transcribes in a reverse direction. It produces an antisense RNA from this SMER. Now this SMER, the RNA from this SMER can bind with this polycystronic mRNA in this region, and it will degrade this part, not the entire RNA. Probably this is controlled by this peptide, you can say, and it forms a complex like structure. When scientists tried to immunoprecipitate this RNA, the SMER RNA, antisense SMER RNA, they co-precipitated this small peptide also with that. And along with that, they also co-precipitated the antibiotics. So when the antibiotic is added, then what happens? This small peptide, it forms a complex with the antibiotics. And that complex binds with the help of it also binds with this RNAs, the antisense RNA, forming an antibiotic dependent ribonuclear protein complex. antibiotic ribonuclear protein complex, ARNP complex. It forms an ARNP. There are three things are there. You have the antibiotic, the peptide molecule, and also this mRNA, antisense mRNA. So when this complex binds with this region of the polycystronic mRNA, this part of the SMER region is degraded. But the SMEA and SMEB, that region remains, and that synthesizes the multi-drug efflux pump. This polycystronic mRNA leads to the protein synthesis of a multi-drug efflux pump, and the antibiotics are then effluxed. They are removed from the cell. They are pumped out from the cell. This is how the cell achieves resistance against this kind of antibiotics. Using the TRIP-L peptide. So here is the role of the peptide, the small peptide tryptophan that is produced from the ORF, small ORF present within the tryptophan leader sequence. This is what interesting feature about this tryptophan L, that it contains an ORF, and that small ORF has a lot of function. And this is the very latest paper. It came out in 2020 in Molecular Biology and Physiology by Hendrick and Mellier. And probably this opens a new window of research about the multi-drug resistance property in some other bacteria also, maybe, I don't know, pathogenic bacteria, how they behave. And there might be similarity that will be detected later on. So this story is very, very interesting, that how this small peptide as well as this small attenuator RNA, they control the synthesis of tryptophan on one hand and the multi-drug resistance property of the cell on the other hand. So that was all about the video lecture about the tryptophan operon. It was in fact in three parts. Those who want to see the previous parts, there will be four videos. In fact, one video will be made after this is over. I will split it into three parts for the part one, part two, part three portions separately. Three videos will be there, and there will be a video of entire. A combination of all three. So those who are interested to study the whole matter, they can go into the total video. And since people are not very interested, I can see that there are very few students who are interested to know more about certain topic, go into in-depth study of a certain topic. They just usually want a shortcut method. So here these videos are not properly for them, but the part one might serve their purpose. So here I'm ending the video lecture. Thank you very much.